everyone. I hope everybody is safe and healthy and taking care of themselves and hopefully staying out of trouble. As you can see, I'm in the great outdoors. Actually, I wish I was, but I'm in an indoor-outdoor house. I'm going to get myself a travel pass and come to this beautiful place, which will be my home for the foreseeable future, where I can stay safe and healthy and hopefully out of trouble. I also have dogs for company, which is great for me. Now let's talk about 2020. See, I told you there are dogs here. 2020 started on an extremely positive note for me. I had listed down adventures I would embark upon this year. January is my birthday month, and I decided that this will be the year when I will take charge of my body and my brain, which is to say that I will work out, I will eat right, and I will keep my mental faculties engaged and chill. You know, just be chill. Be chill, Sharon, I told myself. Little did I know that 2020 had a lot in store for us. Sometimes I feel like we're in a Robin Cook novel. You know, at war with an enemy we can't really see by staying home, and becoming strange germaphobes who wash their hands 20,000 times a day and are wary of meeting people for fear of catching a disease we have no idea on how to beat. We've been in lockdown for about 90 days now, and because I've had so much time on my hands, I have read new books and I have reread some of my favorite books. And I decided to do a video on all my lockdown reading for you guys. And do know that all the books discussed in this video are listed in the description box below. So you can always get a helpful list in case you are wondering on what to read next. Okay, I'm here to help you. So what I've done is I've turned this video into two sections. One is the rereading section and the other one is, of course, reading. So let's start with section one, which is rereading. I won't lie, the initial days of the lockdown were great for me. I began exercising, eating healthy, and my work from home also made me super productive. I didn't really miss going out and meeting friends. If I were to ignore what was happening in the world around me, I could almost forget that we are in the throes of a raging pandemic, which is killing thousands of people and uprooting lives. I was also very conscious of my privilege, and I did what comes naturally to me when I know I cannot control my situation. It's to dig my nose into a grand fantasy and lose myself in its pages. Hence, naturally, the first book that I reread is Mort by Terry Pratchett from his Discworld series. To deal with my own mortality, you know, since the book is based on one of my favorite characters, which is death. Side note, you can watch my How to Read Terry Pratchett Discworld series video, which is listed also in the description box below in case you want to know more about Discworld and about Mort. I've spoken a lot about it in deep detail, so I won't get much into what Mort is really about. But I will leave you with this. I reread Mort often during my very, very difficult times. It's also because death's quotes are savage burns. Like this one. That's mortals for you, death continued. They've only got a few years in this world and they spend them all in making things complicated for themselves. Fascinating. It's just truth bombs like these that really make me grab onto Mort. Anyway, that's what I mean about rereading Mort, which is to basically give myself a reality check once in a while. The other book that I want to talk about that I have reread is a book that I often reread, and it's so that I can reignite my faith in humanity for writing trash that you can't help but love. It's called Demon's Mark by Nora Ash. You guessed it, it's Demon Erotica, Mera Pehla Pyar. If you don't know this by now, reading Demon Erotica is my guilty pleasure. I seek it out like you would watch an episode of Vampire Diaries, just to feel good. Demon's Mark is book one of six of the paranormal romance series. It's the story of this girl who is gifted with the vision of seeing demons. Her name is Selma Lehman, and one day she's attacked by a demon who locks her in a psychiatric facility by pretending to be a doctor. And only Selma can see his true self, which is like this hideous creature with eyes like fire and devil's horns. The only person who can save her is this demon lord who, with a tortured past and darkness in his heart. You can guess what happens next. You don't need me to tell you that. All I can say is that when you're looking for that perfect mindless read that is also feel good and a palate cleanser, this book is perfect. Bahut maza aayega, I promise. Okay, now I'm done with my rereading. I'm going to now move into my section of reading new books. Okay. So the first book I want to talk about is this book called Caging Skies by Christine Lunens. This is the book that Taika Waititi adapted into the Oscar-winning Jojo Rabbit. He picked up the best adapted screenplay for it. It's a super fun read. It's a dark comedy about a 10-year-old Nazi kid enrolled in the Hitler Youth Program. He's bought into the Hitler propaganda of the superiority of the Aryan race and that Jews are dirty, filthy demons. One day he discovers his parents are hiding a Jewish girl inside his house. At first he is angry, then he is scared, and eventually he comes to realize that the Jewish girl Elsa isn't as bad as he is being taught that Jews are, and he begins to harbor feelings for Elsa. He falls in love with her and eventually becomes responsible for her safety as the World War rages on. It's poignant, heartwarming, funny, and gripping. It shows you the worst side of the Holocaust through a child's eyes and teaches us that hope is to be found in not just the darkest of places, but also in the most innocent of hearts. Bhai wah! I first read the book and saw the movie. The main difference between the two is the addition of this flamboyant, childish personification of Hitler as the kid's imaginary friend that makes the movie even lighter. I'm happy to say that I loved both, and I highly recommend that you do the same. That is, to read the book and then watch the movie. The second book I want to talk about is not a book. It's literally a trip. It's called How to Change Your Mind, What the New Science of Psychedelics Teaches Us About Consciousness, Dying, Addiction, Depression, and Transcendence by Michael Pollan. You know what? Some people say that books have a way of finding you at the right time and in the right place. My friend Sriti gifted me this book a year and a half ago, and I wasn't ready for it at that point, so I shelved it. It's our current Shiny Happy Book Club Book of the Month, and I thought, chalo, let's dive in. For those of you who don't know, Shiny Happy Book Club is an initiative that Books on Toast and Here Comes the Sun has started together. And what it does is every month it gives you one fiction and one non-fiction book that would help you with any sort of mental issue that you might be having or some unhappy time you might be going. So what we do is we find a curator to curate our two books, and this month our curator is Sriti Jha, and one of those books is How to Change Your Mind. This book, like I said, is a trip. On a premise level, the book is exactly what the title tells you it's about. It's written by this investigative journalist called Michael Pollan, who does a deep dive into psychedelic drugs. You heard me right. It's a deep dive into psychedelic drugs. So what he does is, he goes into the details of how they were discovered, how they helped and healed people, and at what point were they demonized and banned as dangerous drugs. What modern science research says about their uses, and this underground community of shamans and therapists who are healing people through guided trips. Yes, you heard me right, guided trips. All I can tell you after I am done reading this book is that you should read it with an open mind if you're curious about such things, and let the book tell you everything you need to know about LSD, DMT, psilocybin that's found in magic mushrooms and how it affects people. After reading this book, it sent me into this spiral where I have seen interviews and heard podcasts featuring Michael Pollan. To read more about the effects of psychedelics, and I'm really, really intrigued by it all. The only thing I love the most about reading and learning new things and some types of new learning is that it's so immersive that you can lose yourself in online research spirals endlessly. It's like taking a course, and sometimes it's utterly rewarding. In this case, it's a trip. The third book that I read, which I'm completely in love with, is this book called Folk Tales of Bhutan by Khunzak Choren. Khunzak Choren is this Bhutanese author who is also the first Bhutanese author who ended up writing in English. This is, of course, I think, a collection of translations. It's a collection of folk tales for children, and they're really descriptive and visceral. I picked it up at the Bhutan Literature Festival last year, and I had the best time reading these folk tales because they gave me a great insight into the rural life of Bhutanese people. You know, because we can't sit and travel right now, right? So the only way you can travel is if you let your mind wander. And what best way to let your mind wander than to actually read and discover new cultures through books? So Folk Tales of Bhutan is really helping me go back to Bhutan and then go deeper into Bhutan and see all the places that I didn't see. Bhai, you know, because our minds are so fertile right now, all we can do while sitting at home is to imagine where all we can be, right? So you let your mind travel, bhai. So these folk tales basically transported me to Bhutan's green valleys, mountain tops, river systems. Some of the stories reminded me of Panchtantra, and nearly in all of them, there was this fine balance between humanity and nature. So one of the interesting things is that all of the stories start with the phrase Dangbo, Dangbo, which literally means a long, long time ago. It's like a call to start storytelling, right? And the book is a warm, reassuring hug during these cold, unsettling times. And you know what? They just made me happy. The fourth is not a book. It's basically two podcast series. I started listening to two podcasts on fiction by the New Yorker magazine. One is called The Writer's Voice, New Fiction from the New Yorker, and the other is called The New Yorker Fiction. Both are readings of short stories published in The New Yorker, read either by the author or by a famous fan. So the ones that stood out the most to me are David Means reading Two Nurses Smoking, George Saunders reading Love Letters, and then there are stories like Brian Washington reading Haruki Murakami's UF and Kushiro, Margaret Atwood reading Alice Munro's Quarry. I'm still listening and discovering new stories, and they're very well produced earworm experiences. I mostly listen to them when taking an evening walk in and around my area, and it really feels like I've transported to some other place and, you know, listening to somebody else telling me their story while sitting in their living room. So again, mentally I'm traveling. Currently I am reading Haruki Murakami's Hardboiled Wonderland and the End of the World. So this is one of the first books that was translated by Murakami, of Murakami's. And It also came before his breakthrough novel, Norwegian Wood. And for some reason, I've had this book for a while and I've just never gotten around to reading it. I'm reading it now. I'm also in a place which really, you know, lets my imagination run free because I'm in this like outdoorsy space. And I've only begun reading it. And what I can tell you is that it's really wonderful. It's magical. It's one of his earlier books, and it's a fantasy and a sci-fi novel with two stories unfolding in parallel. One is Hardboiled Wonderland and the other is The End of the World. It's transportive and magical, and both have unnamed narrators set somewhere in the future and an alternate fantasy. Bahut maza aa raha hai, padh rahe hain hum, acha lag raha hai. And what I can tell you is that there's a reason I have picked up books that have allowed me to mentally travel a lot. I have on purpose avoided books that were dystopian in nature or subject matters that have been very deep and dark and distressing. I have read a lot more, but I'll be honest, I'm in a space right now where I have picked up a book and left it because, not because I have not found those books interesting, but they were leading me through a dark place and I don't want to be in a darker place than the world right now. So I'm escaping to brighter lands filled with great promises of fun trips. So yeah, guys, I'm tripping. These are the books that have really helped me trip during these 90 days of lockdown. And you tell me, what have you guys been reading? Have you guys read anything new and interesting that has really helped you transport mentally into new lands and new places? Have you been rereading things and, you know, just to keep yourselves happy and sane in times of like extreme distress like these? Let me know in the comment section. I would love to find out what your reading selections have been during this lockdown. And yeah, tell me if you discovered anything new that I should be doing and I should be focusing on. Podcasts have been my discovery during this lockdown. I have been listening a lot more than I used to before. And yeah, if you guys liked any of these books, like I said, they are listed in the description box below. If you like this video, please like it here by giving us a thumbs up. Share this video with your friends and subscribe to our channel because subscription is free for now. And show us some love because we are always here to show you book love, okay? So you take care, stay healthy and stay positive and keep reading, okay? Bye.